हेलो लर्नर्स, आई एम डॉक्टर सुबोध किशरवानी वर्किंग विद इंदिरा गांधी नेशनल ओपन यूनिवर्सिटी इन एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर कैपेसिटी. द टॉपिक विच वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक टुडे इज मेथड्स ऑफ सैम्पलिंग. इन अवर प्रीसीडिंग सेशंस वी हैव ऑब्जर्व दैट हाउ द सैम्पलिंग इज गोइंग टू प्ले अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट रोल एंड वी हैव सीन दैट हाउ द सैम्पलिंग इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट इन्ग्रीडियंट वेन यू टॉक अबाउट यू नो द रिसर्च वेन यू टॉक अबाउट द रिसर्च डिजाइन वेन यू टॉक अबाउट यू नो formulation of objectives. So what we have observed that as far as the methods of sampling is concerned, this method of sampling is a phenomena, is a methodology which is a very important ingredient when we are going to initiate our research. So in the preceding sessions we have seen that the curtain raiser to sampling, but this session talks about the methods of sampling. And when we start formulating the sampling, I think it is going to be bifurcated into probability sampling or non-probability sampling, or rather we can say random sampling and non-random sampling. So today discussion revolves around the first important ingredient of method of sampling, that is the random sampling or the probability sampling. So in the forthcoming lecture we are going to talk about this the other methods of sampling. So anyway, we are going to just recapitulate today what exactly we have done in our preceding sessions, and it starts with the business research or the curtain raiser to research. Then there were certain research thoughts which was taken care, and FAQs were also there, which was building the framework that how the questions which comes in the grassroot researcher's mind need to be taken care. Then research methodologies are there. So what we observe that this research plan and research problem, research design, collection of data and hypothesis were very elaborately explained, and in the preceding session the sampling was taken care. So when we go more into the depth of the sampling, I think we start with the choosing of population, and from that population we earmark certain sample, and then from there we use the statistical tool analysis and come to the conclusion. So this whole process is quite meticulous in nature, quite methodical in nature, and lot of algorithm and statistics are going to be used, and this is where this methods of sampling is very important ingredient. So the today discussion, if you talk about revolves around the random sampling and non-random sampling, and when we go more into the depth of this particular theme, I think we should explain with the help of this circle. If you see this particular circle, the outer part of the circle is called population, which is in blue color. Then you have target population determined by the sample criteria. So on the basis of hypothesis, on the basis of we defined that this could be the sample, and we are going to cater ourselves to this particular circle only. So if you see this particular image, I think the outer circle talks about the population, and the inner circle, this is orange color circle, talks about the target population. So that is very important, that what could be your population, what could be your target population. And it's like that when somebody start the research and take the jurisdiction as India, pan India, or the Delhi or the particular state, so that the population could be the particular state, but your target could be like what are the domains which you are going to take, that is more important. So it's really cumbersome for the researcher or for the statistician to concentrate on the whole population. So again, you have to narrow down yourself to the particular target and try to determine by that sampling criteria. So this orange circle talks about the sampling criteria. Then accessible population. Now the issue is that sometimes we define our circle or define our outer world, but we are not in a position to get the access of that. So it's very important to talk about the accessible population, which is quite important, because as a researcher you are going to focus, you are going to confine yourself to this particular population only. And then you see again the smaller, the last second last smaller circle is there, which is in orange color, and talks about the sample selected with sampling plan or method. So we have talked about how the methodology is going to apply. This is where we are going to apply the methods of sampling. Either it could be random sampling or it could be non-random sampling. And there are certain the the subheads which comes under the random sampling. So and if you talk about like, you know, the cluster, the stratified sampling or simple random sampling, whereas when you talk about, you know, non-random sampling, you are talking about the quota or judgmental sampling or lot of other sampling methods are there. So what we are going to do in this particular discussion, we are just concentrating on this random sampling part, and we try to find out that what are the parameters which comes under the ambit of that. So element and subject or participants are there, and finally you see that this is the smaller circle talks about subjects or participants. I think this is where, you know, the respondents are there, and these respondents are reciprocating on the basis of the questionnaire you are going to frame. So what we are going to do, that there are certain questions which again comes in the mind, because how confident precise in the results do we want to be, we need to be determined sample size for the produced test. And you know, sometimes you are 100% confident, like whatever the hypothesis you have taken, and you are thinking that it could be accepted, but at the end, you know, when respondent reciprocates, it's rejected. So this is the phenomena which used to come always. Sometimes the situation seems to be favorable in nature, sometimes the situation need to be adverse in nature. So how you're going to cope up yourself, how you're going to come out from this, you know, this juggling format, that is where, you know, this methodology is going to play a very important role. And this methodology is quite meticulous in nature, which I have told earlier, and there are certain mathematical and algorithm analysis are involved. So whatever the results used to become, it's quite, you know, fruitful in nature. So, but on the other hand, there are certain errors also. So, like there are certain margins of error, and there are certain statistical errors also. So, we will have a dedicated session which exclusively talks about that, what could be the statistical errors and how these errors comes. And when, you know, when we started our journey with you know, the simple random sampling, which could be one of the domains of probability sampling or random sampling. But after certain time, we realize that we have to apply, you know, the cluster sampling or the stratified sampling, then again we have to reframe our you know, the data in such a manner that we try to get the good results. And when you're talking about the stratified or cluster sampling, I think we will definitely throw a light and elaborately talk about that, how much important this phenomena is. So sometimes, you know, whatever the methodology we apply, it fails. So in other case, we have to have certain substitutes with us, we have to have certain options, and these options are then applied. So sometimes what happens, we are not, you know, getting the results through simple random sampling. So in that case, we apply the stratified random sampling with the help of certain strata or certain groups, and these groups are, you know, further work as a representative, and from there we try to get the data. So the example which I have quoted in my past discussion also, that if we are going to concentrate ourselves on the particular state and rather than, you know, randomly going into the depth of the state, we meticulously bifurcated into north, south, east, west, or certain zone wise. It could be 7 to 8 subheads, or maybe 10 or 15, and then we can gradually, you know, collect the data from each strata or each group. So that is the model which need to be taken care of, and this is the methodology, this is the model which need to be done. So we can only afford a sample of, no worries, we will be get 100% results. So margin of error is something which is sometimes quite good, and it's not like that when you get the statistical error you should be embarrassed. And when you are getting, you know, a good when you're getting a statistical error, I think it's provide you an option to think more about it and try to recapitulate ourselves and come to the conclusion which can be done with the help of some additional methods. So that model need to be taken care of, and we have already talked about, you know, what exactly the sampling is in our preceding session, and we see that population is there, then sample frame is there, and this is the sampling process, then sample, and what you actually observe in the data, that is more important. So when you're applying the methodology, inferences is statistical inferences, I have already talked about descriptive analysis or inferential analysis. And when you talk about the descriptive analysis, again some stereotype statistical model is going to apply. But when you're talking about inferences, inferential statistics or inferential analysis. There you can apply certain methodology which is you know in the form of sampling method. So we will talk about, you see how the population is, you know, is there, and how the random sampling is just, you know, extracting the data from the big population, from the universal, and try to reach to the conclusion. So rather than, you know, exploring this whole circle, the random sampling methods can take a small portion of the cake, which I have already talked about, and try to judge the taste or, you know, the quality of the product. So this is the parameter which need to be taken care, and random sample is one of the ingredients. You have got non-random sampling also. So we will talk about what is the difference between random sample and non-random sampling, and how and when we have to apply this random sample, and when we have to go for non-random sampling. So anyway, I think this is a population, this is a sampling methods for selecting a subset of members from population in order to infer, because subset is what I have already talked about, that population is a set, and when you're going for the sample, it could be a subset, because small portion of that particular population need to be taken care, and there are certain methodologies which need to be applied, because it's not like that randomly you go into and just, you know, extract the data from there. There must be certain modus operandi, there must be certain procedures which can navigate you, that you can start your journey by this particular aspect and then lead to the conclusion. So when you are going to apply the methodology, when you are going to go and apply certain test, and you can also rectify yourself with certain statistical errors, I think the data which is supposed to be collected is a foolproof data and have a very mind-boggling result. So when you are getting a good results, when you are getting a, you know, a bias, unbiased results, I think that is beauty of the researcher. So if the researchers, you know, get the data by using the sampling pedagogy, I think there are certain results which comes, and it could be quite good, because if you go for you know, exploring the population every time, because population is in big number or big size, so ultimately it's really a cumbersome process. But if you apply the sampling methodology, if you apply certain, you know, the pedagogy, I think you reach to a conclusion in a very faster mode. So that could be, because with the change of time, you can, because this statistical analysis or, you know, this sampling pedagogy is a routine affair, is a regular affair. So once you have reached to the particular conclusion, I think certain concept which comes up again and again, you have to start the journey. So this statistical model need to be done in a routine manner, or in a certain intervals, or after certain time. So if you have a pedagogy, if you have a sampling methodology which had been developed, I think you reach to a very good conclusion, and it can facilitate you always. So, and it can be helpful for the future researchers also. So the pedagogy which you have used and chosen, I think that modus operandi or the legacy need to be taken care by the future researchers also. So that is the reason we talk about, you know, the findings, or, you know, the scope need to be given to the future researchers. So anyway, we will talk about, you know, the certain things like types of sampling. And if you talk about, you know, types of sampling, it could be probability methods or non-probability method, it could be random sampling or non-random sampling, also known as. And when you go into the depth of this random sampling, you come to know that it does not involve human judgment. Whereas when you talk about non-probability methods, it involves human judgment, requires a sampling framework, and no sampling frame required. And it could be, the example is simple random, which I have talked about, systematic sampling, stratified random sampling, cluster sampling. There are certain some other, you know, the sampling which could be multi-stage or area sampling is there. So we will just, the today discussion revolves around the probability methods or, you know, the random sampling. And if you see this random sampling, we have simple random sampling, systematic, stratified, cluster, area, and multi-stage. So all these, you know, the six component needs to be taken care, but the more frequent in nature is, you know, the top four, that is simple random, systematic, stratified, and cluster. So now we will start with the probability or random sample. And if we see this random sample, I think this random sample is a sample that is chosen randomly. That is very true. It's the word itself explains that randomly you can choose it, and it's quite simple in nature, and it could be more accurately called a random sample, because random samples are used to avoid bias and other unwanted effects. And unbiased random sample is important for drawing conclusion, because if you have a certain, you know, accepted notions in your mind, I think you never reach to the conclusion. So that is the reason, you know, we comes up with certain assumptions when we have a hypothesis, and when we go for, you know, applying those hypotheses, then sometimes those hypotheses accepted or in majority of cases could be rejected, because as an individual, as a researchers, when we have gone through certain literatures that, or you know, and that literatures are massive in nature, and from that we frame certain objectives, we are quite, you know, biased in nature, because it follows the individual approach. Individualistic approach need to be taken care. But on the other hand, when you are going for this particular respondent views, there the things come, because the individual opinion differs from the opinion given by the masses. And when, you know, when you take the opinion from the masses who are you know, revolves around that particular thing, I think more holistic view comes up, and this holistic view is quite robust in nature, and this can definitely, you know, helpful for building the research. So in majority of cases we observe that whatever the assumption, whatever the presumption we have taken in the beginning stage as a hypothesis, which we usually call the null hypothesis, in majority of cases it could be it could be rejected. So so alternate hypothesis supposed to be taken care in that case. If you know the sample size talks about something else or give the different results. So interested to work with sample of observations and selected from a population, and relationship between the population and the sample, that is always there, because if there could not be any relationship between the population sample, I think you lead to a different conclusion. So whatever the universal is there, whatever the population is there, whatever the target population is there, and on the basis of that, the sample need to be taken care. It need to be revolved around that particular population. So it's not like that you have taken, you know, a pan India or the state as a research population, and you are going and taking the data from the different state. So that is the reason, you know, the different kind of research comes, and it usually happens, you know, when any kind of good research conduct in the Western world or in the foreign world, we observe that the country like India or the small countries where the researchers are just, you know, concentrating what exactly the world is doing, they create a replica of that. And when these replica are created, I think somewhere the gap used to come, because what we used to say that the impact of, or the criteria of choosing the particular respondents, or the behavior of the consumers, or the opinion of the respondents varies, because the Western world have got a different mindset, where if you talk about, you know, the people who are located in a different country where this phenomena had recently been developed, I think the model need to be differ. So that is the reason, you know, when any researcher is just, you know, doing a add-ons to the particular research which already had been done, I think there are certain parameters, there are certain models which need to be taken care. So if you are going to focus on the grassroots problems, or you know, the indigenous problems or the domestic problems, and try to create a population on the basis of that, and then, you know, concentrate on the sample, I think you get the results which could be quite customized in nature, or rather we can say more tailor-made in nature. So this is the model which is there. So use the probability distribution as a model for a population, and sample from the population to make decisions about the populations. And it's not like that the population is taken just as a window dresser. You have to have a model in such a manner that whatever the sample you have taken by applying, you know, certain pedagogies or the random sampling or non-random sampling, you should be able to make the decisions. And so that is how you're going to make the decisions. I think the beauty of the questionnaire preparation is very important. If your questionnaire is designed in such a manner that it can lead to a good results or good, you know, reciprocation by the respondents, I think it can provide you a roof to take a good decision. So that is where things are very important. And when you talk about the probability sampling, you know, generally I have talked about it's bifurcated on the four important gradients, that is simple, random, systematic random sampling, stratified random sampling, or cluster random sampling. So if you talk about the simple random sampling, all elements are considered and each has equal chance of being selected. This is a, you know, a beauty of the simple random, and we will elaborately talk about these four components. And when you talk about the systematic, every nth element chosen started at random and picking every nth element in success. So that is there, and you have certain system like if you are going to cater, you know, the 2,000 or 3,000 students of any institutions, and you are going to apply the systematic. In that case, what is going to be that after the fifth term or 10th term or 20th term need to be taken. So the element which used to come at the 20th place, and element again used to come at the 40th place, need to be taken as a sample. So you make certain element and earmark certain point, and you are going to systematically take that. So 20, 40, 60, 80, like that, in intervals of 20. So when you're going to talk about the stratified sampling, I think this is quite important, because this stratified sampling works on the basis of strata and group, rather than taking the data from the big basket. You have discriminate them on the basis of colors, on the basis of caste, on the basis of creed, and then try to take the particular information from that particular class and creed. So this is the model which is there, where there is a representation from each strata or each group, and each group is getting get an opportunity to get it accessed or get it evaluated. So stratified sampling talks about that. And when you talk about the cluster is very important on the basis of colors, on the basis of class and creed. You bifurcate this particular thing and reframe under the ambit of the clusters, and these clusters are taken as it is. So if you are going to do the research, the particular cluster had been taken. So population divided into clusters, random sample of clusters selected from the sample random design. So we will talk about in a more elaborative manner. We see that what exactly the simple random sample is. And simple random sample is a size of n is a sample chosen by a method in which each collection of n population item is equally likely to comprise the sample. And the example is that that if you go for a lottery tickets, and I think if 10,000 lottery tickets are sold and 5 are drawn as the winning tickets, then each collection of 5 tickets then can be formed in equal likely to comprise a group of 5 that is drawn. So this is a basic, this is a very stereotype model, and follow the random sampling. And it's the first step is make a list, second is assign a sequential number, then third is choosing sample size, and finally use random number generator. So this is the model which is there, and it's quite omnipresent in nature. I think when researcher starts a research, it starts with the simple random sample, and then have got a systematic random sample. The example which I have quoted about that if there could be in a university and 1500 students are there, you are going to wanted a sample of 150 students, then every 10th name could be taken care. So the advantage of this method is that it should provide a representative sample, and the disadvantage is that it's very difficult to achieve because time, effort and money is there. If the population size is in lakhs, I think, and if you have designed the thing in certain interval, that out of 500, 1% can be taken. So again, the data could be quite cumbersome in nature. So now the thing is that you have to, this systematic sample list all the members of the population and then decide upon a sample you would like. So systematic sample, there's a difference between the simple random sample and systematic random sample. This means that selecting a sample with every item or respondents in the sampling frame having an equal chance of being selected. But again, the time taking activity is there, and it's really a cumbersome process. It's a very elaborative process where when you talk about the systematic sampling, selecting item from the list of regular intervals, that is every fifth customer that buys the burger, or every 10th car that buys petrol. So this is the model which is there, and if you observe that there are certain mathematics, there are certain the statistics which are involved in calculating this sampling. So if you are meticulous, if you are doing and following the certain modus operandi, I think you could be in a very good position. Now the stratified random sampling is quite innovative in nature, whereas an example which I have quoted, it's bifurcate on the basis of certain groups or strata, and each and we are going to take the information from each group. So with stratified random sampling, the breaks may not exist, so you divide your target population into groups, and if the example is like one third of each group, like 2 by 6, from 6 yellow you have to take 2, from 6 red you have to take 2, and from 6 blue you have to take 2 has been sampled. So if you have one group that different size, then make sure you adjust your
proportional in such a manner. Like now, at the previous example which I have quoted, that if you have to take 1/3 from each group, I think you can take 3 colors are there, you can take from one from or two from each group, whichever you know the population of 6. Now if you have to take a number which could be quite different in nature, like 5 from the total, then what you have to do? You have to have models such like that 3 you can take from one colors and one from each color. So this is called stratified random sampling, because there are certain strategy behind it. And this stratified random sampling is, if you see this stratified random sampling, the advantage is that the sample should be highly representative of the target population, and therefore we can generalize from the results obtained. So whatever the results comes, it's quite generic in nature. It's not like that, because you are going to have a representation from each group, and each group is you know getting a weightage. So there is no chances that any of the groups or any of the colors or any of the you know the class has been eliminated. So this disadvantage is that stratified sampling is that gathering such a sample would be extremely time consuming and difficult to do. I think when we are you know, and the method is rarely used in psychology. So that is very true. If you see this, that the population is there, then we have made certain strata, blue, red and green colors, and then from this stratified rambling sampling is there, and how this data is going to be taken care from population to this stratified sampling. So what we have observed that, you know, as far as sampling is concerned, the biggest challenge which is coming up is about, you know, the how you're going to collect the data, that is, you know, the cumbersomeness, and second is, you know, the time taken. So this is the biggest challenge which is coming in all the sampling phenomena. Because why it is coming? Because just to save the time, you are applying the certain methodologies, and these methodologies are working on the basis of small portions. So you, with the help of certain mathematics, with the help of certain statistics, you are going to apply these sampling methodologies and try to gather or cater the informations which can provide you the complete information about that thing. So this is the difference between stratified random sampling. We have seen that in simple random sampling, how this data is going to be extracted, and directly we have taken the data. But there is a chances that some of the class or things can be missed or eliminated. But in stratified random sampling, we have bifurcated into certain groups, and each group is getting the representations. So whereas if you see, while taking this simple random sampling, the blue color had been ignored. So green, black and orange are two oranges are there, but the blue had been mixed. So but here you see that if you take the stratified random sampling, I think very easily you have taken one from green, one from orange, one from black and one from blue. So these respondents are split into subgroups and then randomly selected from each group. So this is the beauty of the stratified random sampling, that it can lead to, now you know, the other model which is very important, that the cluster sampling. So in cluster sampling, the sampling unit is the whole cluster. And what we have done, you see, if you compare with the previous example, the whole colors, whole data is going to be bifurcated to certain clusters. The cluster one is in yellow color, cluster 2 is in yellow color, then cluster 3 is in red colors, then again cluster 4, cluster 5 and cluster 6 are there. So what we are going to do, if we talk about the cluster sampling, we are, rather than taking one from each group, one from each cluster, we have taken the whole cluster. So this is the beauty. So instead of sampling individuals from within each group, a researcher will study whole cluster. So this is the thing. And the strata are natural groupings, and the simple size of 6 is needed, so 2 of the complete strata are taken. So in this case, what we have done, since we have to take the 6 as a sample, so rather than going for each cluster, we have taken one. So we have taken one yellow, that is cluster 2, and one red, cluster 4, and we have got an option to take from 6 also, if the number is more, the sample size is more. Since the number was restricted to 6, so that is the reason we have taken, you know, one from yellow color and one from blue color, one from red color. So now you see the cluster sampling here also, that we have bifurcated to certain clusters, and on the basis of that we have taken particular cluster only. So there is a biggest challenge that some of the clusters won't get the opportunity to get it accessed or statistics. So this is again, you know, the certain stumbling blocks which are there, and maybe it can lead to the statistical errors. So once we go through and find out the margin of errors or statistical of errors, we will see that how the things are going to be there. So area sampling is one of the subheads of cluster sampling, and it can be one stage, two stage or multi stage, and generally used by the government agencies and agriculture statistics, and where pieces of geographical areas such as district, housing blocks or townships are selected. So data are in big numbers, so we can have, you know, certain sampling. I think the pandemic stage is going on, and we know that there is a corona threat is across the world and in India also. So there, when they are going for knowing about the patients, I think they have made the certain clusters, and these clusters are you know working in that manner. So from that particular clusters, they are knowing that up to what extent, you know, the pandemic or this particular, you know, the disease had attacked, or and how to come out from that, and how to, you know, seed that particular jurisdiction. So this is where, and if you compare with stratified versus cluster, I think the main difference between stratified sampling and cluster is that with cluster sampling, you have natural groups separating from your populations. And for example, you might be divide your data into natural groupings like city blocks, voting districts or school districts. And this is the example you see. What we have done, we have got a population, and on the basis of that, we have bifurcated into certain stratified sampling, and certain strata are there. The first strata, black color, then blue, then magenta, green, then, you know, brown and red. So now if you talk about the stratified sampling, I think you can since make the strata or group very easily, you can extract one of the information from each strata, from each group. And when you talk about the cluster, I think the whole cluster need to be taken. So while taking your research, I think when you're talking about the cluster sampling, rather than taking this particular sample, we have emphasize ourselves to this box and this box. So this is the example of the cluster sampling. And if you talk about the stratified versus cluster, I think both are, you know, comes under the ambit of random sampling or probability sampling. And when to use this, if you talk about the stratified random sampling, it can be used when heterogeneous populations, several different groups are there, and some groups are related to study topics. Or if you talk about cluster sampling, population made of units instead of individuals. So now this multi-state sampling which I was talking about, it's part of, you know, the cluster sampling. We have observed that one stage sampling, two stage sampling, multi-stage sampling. It can be called the area sampling also. So in statistics, multi-stage sampling is taking the sample stage using smaller and smaller groups into each of stage. And multi-stage sampling can be complex from a cluster sampling because it is a type of sampling which involves dividing the population into groups. So in the first stage, you know, you can do certain things, and then in the second stage is there, then third stage is there. So rather than giving the results, so what we have observed that it happens with the exit poll also, when the exit polls occurs, and in some of the areas where the election had been occurred, the exit poll used to be taken, but the result usually comes when, you know, the election used to occur in all the places, like, you know, the pan India basis. Because if you talk about the results occurred in particular place, as far as the exit poll is concerned, I think somewhere it is going to affect the voters also. So this is the model which is there, and we have got other stratified sampling, then volunteer sampling and opportunity sample, but more or less it you know revolves around with that particular four concept, that is cluster, stratified, random sampling, or, you know, the model which I was talking about. So anyway, I think the first part which we have covered as far as the method of sampling is concerned, which was purely talking about the random sampling, and we have seen that how much important the sampling is, and there is a challenge of collecting the data, because the way data is coming up, as I have already talked about, that, you know, today world talks about the big data analytics and analysis of data, and how you're going to analyze the data, how you're going to, you know, recapitulate your data, or you can twist the data. So that is the beauty of the sampling, because when you have got a big population, it's really tough, and there is chances of margin of error, there is chances of statistical error, because you can't get the optimum results, you can't get the 100% results. And when you are going to talk about the optimality, I think optimality should be always 100%, should not be 99.9%, because when you talk about the optimality, it could be talking about the there could not be any no opportunity cost. If there could be opportunity cost, I think the optimality is going to be affected. So when you are using the sampling, the intention is very clear that there must be a less opportunity cost, there must be a less scope of errors, so that whatever the results used to come, that could be foolproof and that can represent the particular population. So that is the basic intention about the sampling, and methods of sampling is working as a driving force, as a one of the important ingredient to accomplish your task and reach to the conclusion. And when we are in the process of, you know, reaching to the conclusions, I think there are certain pitfalls, there are certain, you know, the obstacles which used to come, and we have to apply certain, you know, model in between. So it's not like that when you are going in the process of using the sampling or methods of sampling is going to apply, you should you know, quite rigid in nature. There are certain time when you are quite happy with the stratified sampling or, you know, the systematic sampling, but after certain time we see that the cluster sampling is going to give the more good results. So in that case, we have to twist ourselves, we have to, you know, work as a juggler, which I have usually called in my previous discussion, that one has to be quite flexible and one has to see the scenario and then decide what exactly they have to do. Because what we observe that if you understand the scenario and work accordingly, I think you reach to a very good conclusion. And that is the reason, because there is a lot of challenge which is coming always, and if you are going to equip yourself with those challenges and forecast in such a manner that you can reach to a conclusion, because there is no set rule, there is no rocket science when you are talking about the sampling, that I can use, you know, the cluster sampling, or, you know, we can use the stratified sampling or simple random sampling or systematic. But we have to see the scenario. Sometimes, you know, the good results comes in the beginning stage with you know, the cluster sampling, but after certain time we see that, you know, the non-random sampling, which we are going to discuss in our forthcoming session, like convenience sampling or judgmental sampling or, you know, the quota sampling, is going to give the different results. So we have to then jump to, but there must be certain logic behind that. I think if one have a logic behind, you know, taking anything, that is something which is foolproof in nature. So thank you, learners. I think we have talked a lot about this particular model, and we are going to talk more about this particular theme, because I think non-random sampling is somewhat a second half of this methodology of sampling. And if we are able to interpret that method of sampling, as far as, you know, the non-random sampling or probability non-probability sampling is concerned, I think then we can able to interpret ourselves in a more strategic manner and lead to the conclusion. And when you are talking about sampling, I think we have to be quite open in nature, because the whole world today talks about openness and how much, you know, you are flexible about, you know, adapting the things. And more important is the adaptability. As a researcher, you know, one has to go through and mug up, you know, the literatures in a routine manner. It's not like that you have reviewed the literature in the beginning stage and you have chosen the topic and formulate the objectives, but end of the day, you know, you are not updating yourself. So updation need to be a routine matter and a regular phenomena. If you are updating yourself in a more frequent manner, or in between you have observed that some new concept had come, new change had come up, and you are going to adapt those change, and this change can force you to apply certain methodology or revamp your methodology, I think the learner or researcher has to adapt those. And if they are going to adapt those pedagogy, I think the result which used to come is quite, you know, contemporary in nature, or more we can say it's going to give a very, very good results. So thank you very much. We have some more sessions in coming days. Thank you.